taking part in our programs. We, on behalf of all the senior faculty here, invited faculty and dear students, we wish a very successful tenure as principal. And I only would wish sir becomes the vice chancellor for the medical university in the Bangalore. So he takes more higher heights, all the academic programs and multiple collaborations. We wish you a very successful tenure, Dr. Ishwar, sir. Thank you so
much. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, sir. Please proceed, Maharaj.
With the permission of the faculty, now we move on to the next case. Dr. Kirtana, we have eminent vascular surgeons here. I'm happy to invite Professor Albert from Christian Medical College, Vellore. We have Ramanujit, sir. Both of them will be the lead faculty, and senior faculty will be also asking you questions. Over to you, Dr. Kirtana.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Today I'll be doing a case presentation on peripheral vascular disease. I'm Dr. Raj Kirtana, second year postgraduate from Chettinad Hospital and Research Institute. First, I thank Professor Dr. Vivekanandan sir for giving me this opportunity. Also, I'd like to thank my HOD Professor Dr. Raghumani sir. Sir, can I proceed, sir?
Yeah, please proceed.
Yes.
Thank you, proceed.
My patient is Mr. X, a 62-year-old male patient coming from Mahabalipuram in Tamil Nadu. He's a Hindu by religion. He has studied up to third standard and he's a lorry driver by occupation. His income is 7,000 per month and he belongs to upper middle class according to BG Prasad classification. He was admitted on 19th of January this year and I examined the patient on 20th January. He came to the OPD with chief complaints of right leg pain for the past 1 year and a blackish discoloration of right second and third toe for the past 10 days. Coming to the history of presenting illness, the patient was apparently normal 1 year back, after which he developed pain over the right calf and ankle region. It was a cramping, intermittent and non-radiating type of pain, which was gradual in onset and progressive in nature. Initially, the pain appeared on walking a distance of approximately 500 meters and it was relieved on taking rest. And at present, patient has rest pain for the past 2 months. This pain is partially relieved by analgesics and hanging the feet down the side of the bed. There is no diurnal variation in pain and there is no history of pain in the buttocks or thigh pain. There is blackish discoloration of right second and third toe. For the past 10 days, initially it started in the tip of second toe and it progressed to the current state involving the second and third toe. There were no ulcers prior to the blackish discoloration, no history of any discharge fever, no history of any trauma. Patient has no history of chest pain, palpitations, breathlessness, giddiness, syncope, abdominal pain or blurring of vision. He has normal bowel and bladder habits. Past history, no previous hospitalizations or any surgeries. He's a known diabetic for 15 years and he's on oral hypoglycemic agents. He's not a known case of hypertension, TB, bronchial asthma, thyroid disorder or coronary artery disease. Personal history, he's married and he has two children. He's on a mixed diet. He has normal sleep and appetite. He's a smoker for the past 25 years. He smokes 6 cigarettes per day. The smoking index is 150. He's an alcoholic for 25 years and there is abstinence since the past 1 month. Treatment history, he's on OHAs, tablet glibenclamide and metformin. Family history, there are no similar complaints in family and no history of CAD, CVA or any malignancies in the family. Summarizing my history, a 62-year-old male patient from Mahabalipuram who's a known diabetic on treatment, a smoker and alcoholic, who came with claudication pain of right calf and ankle region for 1 year and rest pain for the past 2 months and gangrene of right second and third toe for past 10 days.
Okay. Before we proceed to the examination, okay, right? Sir. Now, can you go to the first slide of your, or what was the chief presentation in this patient?
Sir, right leg pain, sir.
Okay. And you said that the pain is claudication, which suggests that probably it is an arterial disease.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Now, to start with, how do you define a claudication, or what is the difference between a claudication and a pseudoclaudication?
So a claudication pain, it appears only on exercising the limb and it gets relieved on taking rest, sir.
Okay.
It is a cramping.
Anything more to add in the right? So examiners are wanting that word. It is a crampy type of pain that is usually ascribed due to an arterial pathology and is brought by exercising or walking in the limb. So if that is claudication, doctor, what is pseudoclaudication?
Sir, it is a nocturnal cramp-like pain.
Now, okay, so do you know the answer to pseudoclaudication? Pseudoclaudication is usually a sharp tingling nature of pain that looks like a cramp, but is usually due to a neurologic cause. Example, a nerve compression at the spinal region. What is a venous claudication?
Sir, in venous claudication, patient will have a bursting type of pain, sir.
Right. Can you name any condition which leads to a venous claudication? Right, okay. Say a patient with a partially recanalized deep vein thrombosis will have, on a progressive walking, a edema of the leg along with, but we are not talking venous diseases, we are talking arterial diseases today. So now, as we have said, it is a crampy, intermittent and non-radiating type of the pain. Now, as we have said, the pain is in the right calf and the ankle region, and we have described this pain. How did you know that this patient did not have a musculoskeletal cause of pain? Say, for example, an arthritis of the knee joint or the ankle joint.
Sir, there is no diurnal variation of pain, sir.
Okay, so that means the main emphasis of this exercise is to bring from you that what could have been the possible causes of pain in the limb. That can be musculoskeletal, that can be a vascular cause of pain, that can have been a neurology cause or a venous cause. So as you very rightly mentioned, a musculoskeletal cause can be usually associated with weight bearing. Number two, can have a diurnal variation. Say, for example, some arthritis can be seen much more in the morning times of the day. Number three, can be associated with occasional swelling of the joint or on movement decrepitus. So please mark these answers. So the examiner is going to ask you on these points. Okay. I will allow my, I'll request my rest of the, my examiners to ask you on this one, please.
Based on this history, can you hear me, Dr. Peter? Yeah. So based on this history, how do you say that it's arterial?
Sir, it's a claudication type of pain, which gets relieved by taking rest. Okay.
Are there any other characteristics which can pinpoint based on history that this is arterial?
So there is a blackish discoloration, sir.
Claudication. What does claudio mean?
Limp, sir.
Yeah, that's correct. So the limb can be either like what Prof. Ramanu had said, it can be either arterial, it can be neurogenic, and it can be venous. So arterial, what are the other characteristics which are very, very important in your history? Which
is...
What you need to do is you need to characterize this pain a little bit more to pinpointed based on history that it is arterial of nature. So it has to be a repetitive sort of a pain. Okay. So it is repetitive pain and it is reproducible. So a patient who is able to walk about 200 meters and he rests, that is what you've said about 500 meters and then he rests. That is one feature of a claudication, arterial claudication pain.
Yes,
the other feature which is very important is it has to be reproducible and it has to be repetitive on walking the same distance. Okay, so it has to occur. The other clear and most important point is it has to happen in the same muscle group. If a patient walks to 500 meters, develops calf pain, and then he rests, then after that he walks for some more time and then he develops pain in the buttocks. So that is not claudication. So arterial claudication occurs in the same muscle group. So if a patient presents to you with a claudication pain in the calf, on walking a certain distance, which is called as the intermittent claudication distance or ICD. It has to be reproducible and occurring in the same muscle group. And how do you, on history, differentiate it from neurogenic claudication?
Sir, by the type of pain, sir.
Anything else? So neurogenic claudication is a first step claudication. Okay. So usually a particular maneuver tends to precipitate a neurogenic claudication. Like if you increase the intrathoracic pressure, or if a patient sneezes, these sort of maneuver, or when the patient gets up from the bed. So it's an instep claudication. That is the first step itself. The patient will tend to have pain. So that is quite characteristic of a neurogenic claudication. Whereas in arterial, it does not happen with the first step. It happens only after he walks a certain distance and then he develops pain. That is the thing. And then venous claudication, on the other hand, it does not happen in the daytime. Usually it is associated with prolonged standing. And usually it happens at the end of the day. And like you said, it's sort of a dull aching pain, which is not occurring in a particular muscle group, but it does happen in the entire limb. So it is very important for us to bring out these points just based on the presenting complaints.
And the venous pain will depend on elevating the limbs.
Usually the venous claudication gets relieved, whereas arterial claudication gets worse on elevating the limb. So that is another important point which you need to keep in mind. And the other thing what you mentioned was rest pain. Could you just characterize what does rest pain mean? How do you define rest pain?
Sir,
at rest only?
Sir, pain when the patient is in supine position, sir, when the effect of gravity is lost on the limb.
Okay. If I drop a big rock onto somebody's leg, and then he has pain at the rest, pain at rest, is it called rest pain?
No, sir.
Then how do you define? It's very important to define rest pain in arterial disease. So rest pain is something which is a severe form of arterial ischemia. So it is a pain which occurs at rest, usually in the extremities, which is not relieved by adequate analgesia at least for 2 weeks, and usually gets worse in the night. So it's very important that we characterize that. Do you know why this pain is worse in the night? It's very characteristic. So it is a pain at rest, not relieved by adequate analgesia for at least 2 weeks, and it is worse at night.
So it's worse at night because the effect of gravity on the limb is lost. Also, the cardiac output will be low, so the perfusion is getting even less.
Very good. Usually, the sympathetic drive is less, and thereby there is low output. There is bradycardia, and because of which there is less blood supply to already impaired blood supplied limb. So hence, the rest pain is worse at night. So it's very characteristic that a patient who's presented, actually typically if you see a patient with rest pain, they wouldn't have slept for a long time. And if you, the moment you give some form of analgesia, they sleep even through the day. So that is quite characteristic of rest pain, and that is the worst form of arterial insufficiency, which you can get on history.
Yes.
Anything else in history which you should also mention? The other important thing which I noticed that you didn't mention was the opposite limb. Presence of any symptoms on the opposite limb. If a patient who presents with a unilateral limb pain, was it at the beginning, on a temporal profile, did the pain start 1 year ago? Was it like an acute onset? Was it like an acute limb ischemia to start off with, and then it progressed on to developing this chronic pain for the past 1 year? Or was it that it was gradually increasing in size? That is another important history which you need to bring it out on. Your findings.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
If it's acute limb ischemia, what are the 5 P's or 6 P's? Do you know?
Sir, 7 P's are there, sir.
Yes,
pain, pallor, pulselessness, poikilothermia, paralysis, pistol short onset.
One more.
The most important one.
On perishingly cold. Perishingly cold limb.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Doctor, just one tip, just not nothing on an academic front. Yes, whenever you mention in an examination that the examiner is asking you what are the P's of acute limb ischemia, please never tell the examiner there are 7 P's, 5 P's, 4 P's. It obviously happens. Yes. You forget the 5, you remember the 5 and forget the 2.
Ramana sir will have 8, 9, I will have 5.
Okay. So, no sir, absolutely not like that. But okay, so please have, so you are a good student. So please, I know that this is a good question. So take a 1 second break and then gradually mention, okay? Now, so as Professor Srinivasan has mentioned, so you felt that this is a chronic limb ischemia or this is an acute limb ischemia? What is your opinion on this one?
Sir, this is a chronic limb ischemia, sir, because it started and it progressed gradually, sir.
Okay. Why don't you feel that this is an acute or a chronic limb ischemia?
Sir, because it started with claudication and then it has progressed to rest pain, sir. And the claudication has been decreased.
So, very nice answer. So, that means you wanted to say that there has been a progressive decrease in the claudication distance with appearance of a rest pain thereafter. If it had been a case of an acute or a chronic limb ischemia, probably due to an embolus which had dislodged, then in a state of a claudication, the patient would have had a sudden appearance of a rest pain or an embolic episode. So, for example, a sudden blackish discoloration of the limb. Okay, right enough. Now, so given with this one, now let us go to the next part of this, which will probably be a part of your, okay, so this is done. You have said discharge fever. Can you go to the next slide kindly? You have said blackish discoloration of the right second and third fingers in that. Okay, can you go back to the two slides previously, sir? Yes, blackish discoloration of the right second and third. Right, please stop at this one. Right, now this patient is a diabetic for a long duration, I hope.
Yes, sir, for 15
right?
years.
Okay, so, right. Now, a diabetic patient having a toe getting black can be due to many causes, isn't it? One can be an arterial disease. One can be an infection that can happen due to an uncontrolled diabetes. How could you be so clear or sure that this blackish discoloration was due to an arterial pathology, not due to an infection in a diabetic patient with his fingers getting infected?
Sir, prior to the blackish discoloration, there were no ulcerations, sir.
Number one. Number two. Sir, infection would have been associated, as you have very rightly written, that there would have been signs of sepsis. It could have been local signs, like swelling of that area with discharge of pus, or it could have been regional signs, like say for example enlarged nodes in the groin, or a systemic signs like fever. Hence, sir, I felt that this is more due to an arterial cause rather than a infection to be a cause of this one. You have also mentioned there is no history of trauma. Which part of the body did you want to mention that there is no history of trauma? That means I was suggesting that the fingers got black and there is no relationship of trauma to this. Okay, so please be a little clear in mentioning that when you are narrating the history.
Yes, sir.
Right? Okay. Now, go to the next slide kindly. Now, you have also mentioned about chest pain, palpitations, breathlessness. Why have you mentioned these terms?
Sir, to rule out occlusive disease in other arteries, sir.
Okay. The first question is that how common is a coexistent other arteries in the body getting blocked along with the arteries in the limb getting blocked? That means what is the frequency? Say for example, this patient having a coronary or a heart attack.
Yes, sir. There is high chance of associated coronary artery disease.
Okay. As a postgraduate, what did you mean by the word high? Right. So at this point, if you do not answer, it is approximately, statistics differ, but the patient having a myocardial infarction can be up to 10 to 15% in the next 2 years if the limb is now having something called as a critical limb ischemia or a rest pain. So that means myocardial ischemia can be a major problem. So can be a cerebral ischemia producing a stroke, or as you have said, giddiness or syncope as a TIA. What did you mention or what did you want to suggest by an abdominal pain?
The mesenteric ischemia, sir.
Okay, so mesenteric ischemia, blooding of the vision. He had a normal bowel and bladder habits. And now in this one, what is the age of the gentleman?
65, sir.
Okay. Now, in this one, as you have mentioned, bladder and bowel habits, is there any other pathologies that can happen in the genitals in a male in association with a ischemic limb due to probably atherosclerosis?
Sir, if the level of occlusion is iotoiliac, then he can have associated impotency, sir.
You had mentioned no history of gluteal claudication. Is it not?
Exactly.
Kirtana?
Yes, sir.
What is that syndrome called?
Syndrome, sir.
What are the three components of it?
Sir, there will be feeble femoral pulses, gluteal claudication, thigh and buttock, thigh and leg claudication with wasting of the calf muscle, sir.
No. Gluteal claudication, absent femoral pulse. Importance. That's what Professor Raman.
Importance. All right. So please see the direction in which the questions will be going. Okay. So the examiner will try to lead you from one point to another so that to bring out the best from you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. Okay. Sir, please continue.
What type of abdominal pain you're thinking?
Postprandial abdominal pain, sir.
Pardon?
Postprandial abdominal pain, sir.
Why? Postprandial means up to how many hours, and what is the significance of postprandial abdominal pain?
Sir, due to mesenteric ischemia, he will develop abdominal pain after eating.
Eating immediately? 1.5 hours.
Yes, sir.
After 90 minutes and above, patient develops severe abdominal pain. You think of superior mesenteric artery?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
What is the other characteristic finding, clinically, which you get on history in a mesenteric ischemia?
Yeah.
It is to do with appetite and weight loss. So in mesenteric ischemia, essentially there will be normal appetite, but there will be significant weight loss. And it is characteristically called as food fear. So the patient will want to eat, but then is scared to eat food because any time he sort of eats food, he will develop mesenteric angina. So when you go on a systemic review, especially suggesting of arterial insufficiency in the viscerorenal segment, I think it's very important that you mention that there are no history of any anginas, mesenteric angina,
yes,
other than just only abdominal pain.
Can we go to the next?
Okay. I think that we can.
Ajay Khanna, sir?
Yeah, I think that, yes, we can. Yeah, Professor Ajay Khanna, please.
How do you, based on the history, can differentiate that does the patient have atherosclerosis or the Buzzer's disease?
So first is based on the age of onset, sir. If it is Buzzer's disease, it starts before the age of 40 years and atherosclerosis will start later, sir. Then Buzzer's disease affects males more. And Buzzer's, it will be mostly unilateral, sir. And Buzzer's is bilateral, sir. Atherosclerosis will be starting unilateral and later it will progress to bilateral, sir. And history of smoking will be there for Buzzer's disease, sir.
The progress, is it
pre-senile atherosclerosis?
No.
Okay, that will be also in the same age group as that of the Buzzer's.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the young patient, but if there's a family history there or any risk factors which are there, like a patient is hypertensive or the patient has diabetes or the patient has dyslipidemia, all those patients, they can develop all these problems at the younger age group, 35, 40 years. So that is the type of the pre-senile atherosclerosis which is there. Now tell, what are the various types of ischemia? What are the various types of ischemia?
Mm-hmm.
It can be acute ischemia. It can be a chronic ischemia. It can be a critical ischemia. So what is the difference between acute ischemia, chronic ischemia, and a critical ischemia?
Critical limb ischemia, there will be rest pain for 2 weeks, which will not be relieved by analgesics, with the ankle brachial pressure less than 0.3, sir. We define critical limb ischemia with that. And the ankle pressure will be less than 50 and the toe pressure will be less than 30, sir.
Okay. And when do you say it's acute ischemia? 1 hour, 2 hours, 4 hours, 1 day, 2 weeks? When do you say it's acute ischemia?
4 hours, sir.
Acute ischemia is 2 weeks.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so less than 14 days is the acute ischemia. So it's nothing like hours there, it's the days there.
Yes, sir.
But the limb to become gangrenous goes in hours. Okay. So if there is a like embolic phenomena is there, then in that case, the limb may just become gangrenous within few hours. But otherwise, the acute ischemia is up to the 2 weeks time, while the chronic ischemia is beyond 2 weeks. Okay, go ahead with your examination now. Yeah.
Just another comment.
Yes, I think that is.
Just another comment on your summary. Just go back. The summary. So based on your summary, can you pinpoint the anatomical location?
Yes, sir. It is right calf and ankle region, sir. So the level of obstruction will be one level above. So femoropopliteal, sir.
Okay. If it is in the foot?
Tibial, sir.
Okay. And if it was in the thigh?
Iliac artery.
Okay, very good. So it's very important that you present the anatomical location as well.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Coming to the general examination, the patient was examined after verbal consent. The patient is conscious, cooperative, and oriented to time, place, and person. He is moderately built and nourished. The Karnowski performance scale is 80. He is able to do his work with some difficulty. Height is 168 centimeter and weight is 58. His BMI was 20.5. There is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, significant generalized lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. Vitals, pulse is 80. In the right radial artery, it is regular in rhythm, good volume, and no vessel wall thickening. BP is 130/80 in the right brachial artery in supine position. Saturation is 97. He is afebrile and he walks with a limp of the right lower limb. Coming to the local examination, the patient is explained about the procedure and examined under adequate light in both supine and sitting position. Both lower limbs are exposed from ASIS to tip of the toes. So this is a clinical picture, sir.
What is it? ASIS?
Anterior superior iliac spine, sir.
Please try to avoid it.
Yes, sir.
Am I correct, Albert, sir?
Yes, sir. I mean, the other important... Anyway, go ahead with your presentation. We'll... Please
continue with the presentation, doctor.
Yes, sir. Inspection of the right lower limb. There is blackish discoloration of the right second and third toe extending from the tip of the toe to the base. It is dry gangrene with a well-differentiated line of demarcation. There are no skip lesions and there is no discharge. In the surrounding skin, there is redness up to the midfoot and there is edema up to the ankle. On inspection, the capillary filling time is 20 seconds. Berger's postural test, the right leg becomes pale on elevation up to 60 degrees. And there are signs of arterial ischemia present. There is loss of hair, nail changes with brittling and transverse ridges. There is thinning of skin. The skin is stretched and shiny. There are no varicosities. There is minimal muscle wasting seen in the right calf. There are no scars, ulcers, sinuses, or visible pulsations. The thigh of the affected limb is normal. And the left lower limb appears normal. Moving to the palpation of the right lower limb, the second and third toe is cold and clammy. There is localized warmth around the second and third toe up to the midfoot. And there is tenderness in the base of the second and third toe. the gangrenous area, the distal part is hard and shriveled, and there is anesthesia over the gangrenous area. The base of the second and third toe up to the midfoot is edematous. There is no crepitus. The capillary refilling time is 4 seconds. Venous refilling takes more than 5 seconds. And on Fuchs cross-leg test, the oscillatory movements are seen. Coming to the peripheral pulses, in the right leg, the dorsalis pedis, anterior tibial and posterior tibial are absent. Popliteal is feeble. Femoral, radial, ulnar, brachial, subclavian, carotid and superficial temporal on the right side, it is felt. In the left, the dorsalis pedis, anterior tibial and posterior tibial are feeble. And coming to the calf muscle measurement, the right side is 25 centimeter and the left is 28 centimeter. Venous system, there are no varicosities. The fine touch and temperature is normal. Ankle reflex and knee jerk is normal. Plantar reflex is normal. Joint movement, the second and third toe interphalangeal and the MTP joint movement is restricted. Sir, can I proceed with the upper limb examination?
Yeah, proceed. Do you have anything pathology in the upper limb? I don't think so.
No, sir. It's normal, sir.
Okay. So now, can you continue with your examination? I think you will be discussing the diagnosis or the general examination with the other systems, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, before you go to the diagnosis, okay, so auscultation remains, right? Now, I think that we'll need to discuss with that. Can you go back to the slide on general examination, please?
Yes, sir.
Before you start, you see that part is not exactly called general examination. That is called general survey.
Yes,
what
sir.
You do after that, that the local or the cyst, that system examination, so-called vascular examination, that part is general examination. But as a postgraduate, okay, yes. These are. The first question is that why did you mention the word Karnofsky in this patient? Karnofsky performance scale is a particular scale that was made for patients with oncology.
Yes,
cancer patients, particularly yes. Receiving chemotherapy and the need for segregating patients will receive chemotherapy.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is, I do not think that is a very appropriate area to mention a Karnofsky performance scale in this patient. Okay, so but still if you have mentioned, you can defend by saying that, sir, I wanted to express to the examiner the disability that the patient has faced.
Okay,
sir. Okay, right. So this is the first point. So can I go to the next slide, kindly? All right. So you have mentioned these parts. The next part, kindly. Now, when you mention the nodes, it is good to mention that I have seen the groin nodes on the right side and there were no palpable nodes in the groin. But there were some less than 4 centimeter palpable nodes in the groin. It is a good habit to mention that also to the examiner at this point.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. The next point, please. Now, so you have a saturation, you have the gait, and works with a limp in the right lower limb. Now, this is something that is to be appreciated that you have mentioned the word called as gait in this. Again, gait can also be mentioned with your local examination of the or your examination of the vascular system.
Yes.
Now, anything, I will request my co-examiners to ask you anything on the general survey, please.
You want your first case of vascular case, I would expect you to look for clinical markers for atherosclerosis on your general mm-hmm. survey.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes,
any sir. Arcus juvenilis, any centralisma, yes, any acanthosis nigricans, all these things have to be looked for.
Yes, sir.
If there is any central obesity, that kind of thing. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Kirtana, one more important thing is locomotor brachialis. You have to look for dancing brachialis. Nothing but the prominent brachial artery pulsations. They reflect atherosclerosis, okay?
Yes, sir.
Remember, atherosclerosis rarely affects the upper limb, but pulsations of the brachial artery, right? Prominent pulsations. That you need to mention.
Yes, sir.
Well, what is in the general survey, the question was asked to you. So in the general physical examination, apart from the radial artery you mentioned, that vessel wall thickening, etc. So we can mention that locomotor brachialis I have seen, right? Right. That's one thing which you need to add. That's all.
So, now I think that, okay, so you can go to the vascular examination of the limb. So can you proceed to the vascular examination? Now when you say right local examination, doctor, it is good to write the word vascular examination of the lower limb or vascular examination of the upper limb. That creates a better impression.
Yes, okay? Sir.
And the first question is that for a vascular examination of the lower limb, what should be your optimum exposure?
So we have to expose the abdomen also.
Exactly. Why, sir?
Because of abdominal aorta.
Because of the diseases of the abdominal aorta, say for example an abdominal aortic aneurysm, surgeries on the abdominal aorta will have a mark on the or a scar on the abdomen.
Yes.
And number three is that any iliac artery aneurysms, which are not or femoral artery aneurysms, can also be seen in this region. So it is good to expose the abdomen to the feet. So that is the reason about it.
May I just ask something?
Yeah, please.
Kirtana,
yes, sir.
Where do you think you would find an aortic abdominal aortic aneurysm? It is visible in which side of the abdomen?
So in the epigastrium.
Right, it's seen in the epigastrium, right? Also, you said that you expose both the limbs. I don't know if you go to the next slide. I have not. You must compare the two limbs equally about integumentary systems, about the girth, about the length, about the muscle power, about the everything. I mean, it has to be compared.
Yes,
God has given two things, so you have to compare the two things whenever there is one of them is involved in greater detail. You just can't say it's normal and move out, right? What might seem to be normal to you could be abnormal to others, right?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Okay. Now, when you go to the examination of the lower limb, can you go to the next slide, please? All right. So, now, you can start with inspection, then go to palpation, and then to auscultation. And then, as you have mentioned this one, so the only important finding that you have is in the foot rather than anything in the thigh or the leg. Now, in the foot, what are the gross findings? Can you quickly recapitulate them once again for all of us?
Please go on. Yes, sir. There is blackish discoloration of the right second and third toe, sir, from the tip to the base of the toe. A well-differentiated line of demarcation, sir.
Okay.
Then there is around redness and edema up to the midfoot, sir. The capillary filling time is elevated. And venous filling time is elevated, sir. Berger's posterior test, the leg becomes pale at 60 degrees, sir.
Okay, right. So come back to that picture of that patient with that gangrenous leg. Okay, you said that this is a gangrene. Now, if you see the fourth and the fifth digit, particularly the fourth digit, can you zoom in with the picture, please, kindly? Can you zoom that picture if you can? Okay, you cannot. Okay, no issues on that one. Now, what is a pre-gangrene and what is the difference between a gangrene and a pre-gangrene? Or the examiner will be adding the third one, and wet gangrene, dry gangrene, and a pre-gangrene.
Dry shriveled appearance, sir. Wet gangrene, there will be signs of inflammation, sir. It will be edematous.
Okay. But you have said there is an edema in the leg, isn't it?
Yes,
so
sir.
Don't you feel that this is a wet gangrene? You have said this is the reason I got on to recapitulating your examination findings.
Yes.
You said there is an evidence of an erythema, there is an evidence of an edema.
Yes,
and also there is an evidence of a blackish discoloration. So don't you feel that this will be more quantifying as a wet gangrene versus a dry gangrene? Because in an examination, you have to defend yourself, particularly
yes,
in a diabetic patient, wet or dry gangrene. Then we'll come to the term of pre-gangrene.
Sir, in this, it is dry gangrene because the line of demarcation is well differentiated, sir.
Okay, number one, number two.
And it is dry and shriveled, sir.
Number three. Sir, I do not feel for any tenderness around the base of the digit. Number fourth, I do not feel any crepitus in the soft tissues around the base.
Yes, sir.
So this clinically appears to be a dry gangrene. Remember, the word is clinical.
Yes, sir.
But please mind you, a diabetic patient, as Dr. Sahai has said very, very appropriately and rightly, a diabetic patient having a dry gangrene, sir, it is not that it is uncommon. It is present, but definitely take it with a pinch of salt. There will be a component of a spreading infection around the limb.
Yes,
so beware on this point.
Yes,
what is a pre-gangrene?
It means 4 points on pre-gangrene.
Actually, absolutely, because these are the typical examination questions that you will always be asked.
Rest pain, edema, hyperesthesia, color change.
Absolutely. Right. So please remember them.
Rest pain, so these edema, are hyperesthesia, and color change.
Yes, sir.
You right. See in the limb, it is gangrenous, but the other toes, as I said, the fourth and fifth toes, you see, the patient has got rest pain, the patient has got mild edema. There is, if you see for the sensation, there will be hyperesthesia, and there's some color change that professor has noted it. So that is also going in for a gangrene.
Dr. Kirtana, one or two small comments here, especially a vascular case like this. You should have given us the front view of the dorsum nicely so that to clearly appreciate the line of demarcation. Okay. See, both figures, it's not that we cannot make out, but it's not very good picture, number one. Second, you look at the second toe, which is black, shriveled, you told correct. In fact, I can see in the picture the pus there, actually, underneath.
Yes, sir.
Correct. So, there's a pus is very visible there. So, it is still possible that it's a atherosclerotic gangrene. Obviously, a patient has diabetes and barefoot walk, whatever it is, they have got infected also. So, this needs to observe. Next, if you look at the third toe, third one, that is no line of demarcation properly, as at least in the picture what we see there. Yes, fourth is definitely color changes are there. So this is definitely carefully. In secondary infection is definitely there in this patient, right? Pus is seen in the undersurface. Right? That's all. These are my observations. Yes.
I think on palpation, I mean, the palpation is the most important clue to differentiate apart from the other findings which have been discussed. I think on palpation, a dry gangrene will be hard, whereas a wet gangrene will be soft. And like sir had mentioned, there will be crepitus. There can also be a dry gangrene with wet margins, as we see in many of the diabetic patients. So it's very important to note all these findings.
Right. So with this now, so you have gone in for the palpation, and then after the palpation, you have also palpated for the pulses, isn't it? Okay. Now, can you go back to that table where you have palpated for the pulses? Okay. Now, in the pulses, you have said that arteria dorsalis pedis, anterior tibial and posterior tibial.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, you have compared with them and you have mentioned them legends. That is a very appreciable thing. And I think that those of the students who are seeing this should always mention this in their examination sheets. Okay. Kirtana, the first question is that arteria, just a quick undergraduate, some few reminders. Which bone is the arteria dorsalis pedis felt against? Or when do you feel exactly for the arteria dorsalis pedis?
Sir, lateral to the extensor hallux is longest tendon in the metatarsal, sir. First metatarsal. Against the navicular bone, sir.
Right. So, this is a full description that the examiner is wanting from you in an examination. So, against the navicular, in the first metatarsal space, the proximal part of the first metatarsal space, because it disappears in the distal part of the space and is felt lateral to the tendon of the extensor hallucis longus. Right enough. Now, you have also palpated for the popliteal, which appears to be decreased than the opposite one. What are the techniques clinically of palpation of the popliteal? Because can you go to a slide before this? There is a reason of asking.
This one,
you have said there is something called Fuschig's cross-leg test.
Yes,
oscillatory
sir.
Movements are plus. What do you mean by this? and which artery is exactly understood by this maneuver.
So we will do this to look for the popliteal artery pulsation, sir.
Okay. So if this diseased limb, say for example the right limb, has an oscillatory movement.
Yes, sir.
Then, so by this Fuchs test, so what is your inference from this test?
Sir, the popliteal artery is intact.
That means the popliteal artery still has a pulsatile flow, so enough to cause an oscillatory movement.
Yes,
but what is the best way to palpate for the pulsation of the popliteal artery?
Sir, we have to make the patient lie in the prone position, and the knee should be flexed to 90 degrees, and in the lower part of the popliteal fossa against the upper end.
Wait. It is not the lower part, ma'am, of the popliteal fossa. Popliteal fossa is a diamond shaped space. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So when you flex the knee at 90, you are palpating for the upper part of the popliteal fossa. Now, which bone do you feel it against?
Sir, against the medial condyle of the tibia, sir.
Sir, it is again not the tibia. Again, think over. The patient is prone, not supine. So you are at the intercondylar area of the femur, or some people say the medial condyle of the femur, in which you are palpating for the pulse of the superficial femoral, which is becoming the popliteal artery.
Yes, sir.
Right? So this is all about this one. Have you felt the femoral artery at the groin?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, between the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic symphysis, sir, midway, against the neck of the femur, sir.
Again, so this is a perpetual confusion that has lasted maybe for centuries. So it is felt not exactly at the medinguinal point, it is felt an inch below the medinguinal point. So again, so people differ in their opinion. Some people say that it is felt at the medinguinal point, some people say that no, it is felt below this. Right. So what are the major branches of the femoral artery before it becomes the popliteal artery?
Sir, it divides into the superficial femoral and the profunda femoris, deep profunda femoris artery, sir.
Very good. So, this is the only thing that a vascular surgeon needs to know. So, beyond this peripheral pulses, now go back, and then you have also said there is, you did the Berger's test and the Berger's angle.
Yes, sir.
The first question is that why did you do this test? What is the exact interpretation? Or what was the importance of doing this test in this patient?
Sir, a Berger's test, if the angle is less than 30 degree, then it indicates severe ischemia, sir.
Okay, but you already have a dry gangrene.
Yes, sir.
You already have a critical limb ischemia.
Sir, we can...
So, what is the importance of doing this test? Does it add to your any information? Or
Retrous, is it...
Now see, the reason is that because the examiner is gradually again making a trap to trap you. The minute you say that the Berger's angle has become 60 degree, while the leg has two fingers which are already dry, gangrene, there is another leg which is in a state of pre-gangrene. So the main problem is that the examiner will ask you about the reason of doing a Berger's test and the Berger's angle. Okay? So that is the reason. So I will ask my co-examiners to kindly ask now.
Dorsalis pedis is absent in how many percent of individuals, sir?
In 10%, sir.
Please, okay. Albert, sir.
You said in the pulsations.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you are telling about the pulses. What is minus? What is 1 plus? What is 2 plus?
Yes, what sir. Does that mean? Absent, feeble, and felt, sir.
Which is the normal one here?
2 plus, sir.
Okay. And if it is 3 plus, then?
Bounding pulse.
Right. Okay.
Usually pulse.
Tell where do you feel the posterior tibial?
Sir, posterior tibial is behind the medial malleolus, sir.
Against which bone? You know, all the pulses are felt against bones. So tell which bone?
Sir, calcaneum.
Hmm?
Calcaneum,
yes. Against the calcaneum.
Between tendons.
Anterior tibial.
Specific.
Sir.
Where do you feel the anterior tibial?
Sir, midway between the medial and the lateral malleolus, sir.
Against which bone?
Against Okay, lower end of tibia.
Where do you feel the dorsal hispidus?
Sir, against the navicular, sir, in the first metatarsal space, the dorsum of the foot, lateral to the extensor hallucis is longest tendon, sir.
No, you cannot feel it in the space. You have to feel it against the bone.
Navicular bone, sir.
The navicular and the medial cuneiform, which is there. Okay, yes, you can feel there.
Yes, sir.
Where do you feel the popliteal artery?
Sir, in the lower part of the popliteal fossa, sir. In the prone position with 40 degree flexed leg, we can see it in the lower part against the medial epicondyle of the tibia.
Right. Sir, any anterior way of palpating? Where do you keep the thumb?
With both the hands, we can palpate, sir.
No, with the thumbs, where do you keep? Where do you keep the fingers?
Sir, thumb will be kept anteriorly and the fingers will be run posteriorly to feel the artery.
Which bone? Sir is asking bone only.
Bone. Yeah, you are right. Upper end of the tibia.
Tibia.
Now you told upper end of the tibia. That's right. Yeah.
It's just a comment on this popliteal pulse. The popliteal pulse is either palpable or not palpable. Okay. The other thing which is contradicting this is what you've said in your previous examination, saying that cross-leg test was positive.
Yes, sir.
Oscillatory movement. So generally, the cross-leg test, like another prof has commented, is never very significant unless there's an aneurysm of the popliteal artery.
Yes, sir.
So normally, if we do a cross-leg ourselves, we generally will not be able to demonstrate the pulsations of the popliteal artery. So if you've said popliteal artery is feeble, very unlikely that the cross-leg test should be positive.
Yes, sir. So
there's a contradicting statement in that.
Yes.
All right. And that was the general comment about the pulses.
I think that we should proceed now because it is so. Now, what is your diagnosis, Dr. Kirtina?
I'll summarize the findings, sir.
Yeah, please do.
A 62-year-old male patient who is a known diabetic on treatment, alcoholic and smoker, who presented with a dry gangrene of the right second and third toe with the calf pain for 1 year. Both capillary and venous filling time is delayed. Features of arterial ischemia is present in the right lower limb and Berger's test is positive. So I would like to diagnose as peripheral arterial occlusive disease of the right lower limb with the dry gangrene of the second and third toe with femoropopliteal occlusion in the right side and the femoropopliteal disease of the left side.
Okay, so it is better to mention the age of the patient as this because you are mentioning atherosclerosis. So what is the age of the gentleman?
62-year-old patient, sir.
So it is a 62-year-old gentleman, long-term diabetic, smoker, peripheral arterial occlusive disease, as you have very rightly mentioned, with atherosclerosis being the etiology, complicated by a dry gangrene. So more or less, you have given a comprehensive description. Now, the first question is that, as Professor Shenoy has already asked you, can you quickly summarize why did you feel this is atherosclerosis, not a Berger's disease?
Sir, age of onset is 62 years, sir. So I feel it's atherosclerosis. Then it is unilateral, sir. There is no upper limb involvement, no features of thrombophlebitis as in a Berger's disease, no inflammatory features like Berger's disease, sir.
Last one is that the patient is a long-term diabetic, elderly and smoker. All of them cumulatively lead to a evolution of atherosclerosis as a cause in this patient.
Yes, sir.
These are the points, say that, in favor of atherosclerosis in contrast with Berger's disease. You will be asked, as Professor Khanna has also asked you about, what are the presentations of a Berger's disease and what is a pre-senile atherosclerosis. So these will be the multiple questions on this one. Now, I'll request my co-examiners to ask you before we proceed to the diagnosis, before we proceed to the investigations and the treatment.
The other point which you can make in your diagnosis, the second point is the severity. The site you've mentioned, the severity of the peripheral arterial disease. So severity can be classified into either claudication, which is either non-disabling or disabling, or a chronic limb threatening ischemia. Mm-hmm. So in this patient, he will have peripheral occlusive disease, right lower limb, critical limb ischemia, critical limb threatening ischemia, critical occlusion anatomical location, and most probable etiology is atherosclerosis. Now, why do you say it's critical limb ischemia? There are mainly 3 points. One is presence of rest pain. Second is presence of gangrene. Third is if you had done an ankle brachial index, which is less than 0.3. What is ankle brachial index?
Sir, we have to tie the BP cuff above the ankle and we have to take the systolic pressure, sir.
I'm not asking you to describe it. What is it?
Sir, it is a ratio of systolic pressure of the in the ankle, in the dorsalis pedis versus the brachial artery, sir. The highest one is taken, sir. Higher value is taken and the index is calculated, sir.
So it is defined as the highest ratio of, it's an index which describes the highest systolic pressure at the ankle. It can be either in the dorsalis pedis, it can be either in the anterior tibial, it can be either in the posterior tibial. So highest of the three.
Yes,
and that is your numerator. The denominator is highest of the systolic at either brachial artery. So if your right brachial artery, sometimes the patient can have subclavian ostial disease because of which on one side the brachial pressure may be low. So in that case, you cannot use that brachial. So highest of the systolic at the brachial, either brachial. Okay, so that is the index. How do you classify peripheral arterial disease based on ABA?
Sir, normal is 0.9, sir. Rest pain will be less than 0.5 and impending gangrene is less than 0.3, sir.
So it's essentially again divided 0.9 to 1.1 as normal. Less than 0.9 is suggestive of a peripheral arterial disease.
Yes, sir.
Now 0.6 to 0.9 is mild. Okay. 0.3 to 0.6 is moderate and less than 0.3 severe or critical limb threatening ischemia. In diabetics, do you think it will be abnormal?
Yes, sir.
So, is it very low or is it very high?
It is very high, sir.
Why?
So, it's called as fallacy of the ankle brachial pressure index, sir. Due to the calcified vessels, the ankle brachial pressure index will be very high, sir. It will be above 1.2, sir.
So usually, correct. That's correct. There is arteriosclerosis of the media. And that is why it is very difficult to compress the arteries. And because of which, there is a falsely elevated. So, it will be around 1.5, sometimes 2. Or 2.5. Then what do you do? How do you objectively classify peripheral arterial disease?
Sir, we have to do the poles test and we have to do the ankle brachial index again, sir, by elevating the limb and we have to repeat the test again, sir.
Any other test do you know objectively to classify especially in a diabetic? This sort of medial arteriosclerosis is mainly seen in long-standing diabetics and those with renal failure.
Yes, sir.
Any other objective measurements do you know? The other things are basically toe pressure and transcutaneous pressure of oxygen. So,
yes,
if the toe pressure is less than 30 and TCPO2 is less than 40, that suggests that there is, these are all indirect measures because yes, ABI doesn't. The other test which can be done is also a toe brachial index.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so these are the other non-invasive tests which can be done objectively to classify them into severe peripheral arterial disease.
Yes, sir.
Were you worried about critical limb ischemia? What are the other things which can happen if the patient has got a critical limb ischemia? The chances of going in for amputation is 100% the same limb. And the chances of high amputation on the opposite limb is also is there.
Yes,
patient
sir.
Has got high chances of myocardial infarction.
Yes, sir.
Patient has got high chances of cerebrovascular accident.
Yes, sir.
That is why the critical limb ischemia is very, very important.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Please, sir. Raman, sir.
Yeah.
Or Albert,
sir. Right.
Dr. Kirtana, do you know that in the COVID period, something new has come? Like we have got the toe pressure and all those pressures which are there. In the COVID period, something new has come. What is that?
ICU gangrene, sir.
Hmm?
The ICU gangrene.
No. For the measurements. For the measurement purpose. Like we can measure the ABPI. We can measure the toe pressure. We can measure the transcutaneous pressure. Anything else which has come? Which has specially come in the COVID period, Jay. what do you advise any patient to know his, you know, they keep a small instrument with them? Pulse oximeter.
Saturation.
Yeah. So pulse oximeter saturation, which is there. Yes, sir. Based on that, also another classification is coming. Yes, whether it is more than 94%, whether it is between 92-94%, whether it is less than 92% or less than 90%.
Okay,
so based on that also you can classify your patient of the ischemia.
Yes, sir.
That is a new thing which is coming up now.
Yes, sir.
Great. Okay. So now, Kirtana, what is your management plan for, or what is your investigation plan for this patient?
Sir, investigations, first I will go with a routine investigation, sir. I will do a complete blood count, sir, to look for the hemoglobin, WBC count, to look for the infections, platelet count, because we'll be starting on antiplatelets. Then I will do a fasting postprandial and HbA1c to look for the glycemic status of the patient. Also, I'll do a urine routine examination. I will do RFT, sir, because if we are doing CT angiogram, we need to know the creat level. So I'll do RFT. Then I will do some specific investigations, X-ray of the affected part, and I will do culture sensitivity swab from the wound to start on appropriate antibiotics.
Okay, Kirtana, I will stop you at this minute.
Yes, sir.
Doing a blood or urine and urine is usually the answer that you get from an undergraduate, you see. When you have this patient in your outpatient department or in your office or in your clinic, the patient is crying in pain and is requesting you to give some tablets or some injections for relief of the pain.
Yes, sir.
Understand. He is an uncontrolled diabetic or a diabetes with a control.
Yes, sir.
So, you will advise some tests, but at the same time, you advise some medications as well for the patient, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And then you tell the patient to come back to me after a couple of days. And then similarly, you will do something for his two dry gangrenes as well.
Yes,
already you can see a pus point. So whenever you are trying to mention that, remember that you are giving a surgical exit examination.
Yes, sir.
You are a surgeon and you are answering to another surgeon.
Yes, sir.
That means, what is your first priority in this patient with a dry gangrene and a wrist pain?
The
first is pain relief. So please think over giving the patient... Sir, I will advise the patient some analgesics because the patient is really crying in pain. He is in wrist pain. Please remember that.
Yes, sir.
Number two, his leg is in a state of gangrene with an infection in a diabetic patient. That really is an important thing and needs at least an evaluation of his leg for signs of spreading cellulitis, because rather than having only his two toes taken out, you may end up with the other major amputations.
Yes,
if it is a spreading cellulitis or etc. So probably I will think over an emergency X-ray of the leg. Remember, he is a diabetic.
Yes.
Number two, I will also think over giving an antibiotic, at least an oral antibiotic, and doing a dressing after a debridement for the leg before I go on for all the other tests that you mentioned.
Okay, sir.
Then thereafter, I will plan my evaluation of the limb ischemia by sequentially doing two sets of investigation. One for the etiology and number two for the level of the occlusion.
Yes, sir.
So did you understand how we grade, or because in your outpatient department, probably this is the way your teacher does it, your consultant does it, and this is the way you do this. So rather than mentioning or answering like, sir, I will do blood, I will do urine, I think that this is a better way of expression in an examination. Okay, I'll request my co-examiner, sir, any comments or points in this regard?
So this particular, I would say that I will, like what sir has suggested, I would admit the patient, give him, because you've said that he's got rest pain, so I would give him pain relief, and I would confirm my diagnosis. And it's very important and imperative to confirm your diagnosis after the patient is comfortable. So confirmatory tests always come priority over the other routine tests, which generally everybody else says. So confirmatory tests can be either, in this particular case, you can either do a duplex ultrasound or you can do an angiogram. So prior to an angiogram, like you said, you need to have a creatinine. Duplex examination, what do you think you are looking for in this particular case?
Sir, a duplex can, we can see both the anatomy and physiology, sir.
Okay. So what all do you think you will be able to find out on a duplex?
Stenosis, with the flow of the with the flow we can see the stenosis.
So one is the anatomical location you will be able to see on a B-mode ultrasound, and on a color Doppler you will be able to see the flow. And then you can also assess the hemodynamic significance, which can tell you as to how exactly is it, whether it is stenosed, whether it is occluded in a peripheral setting, okay, in a peripheral limb, either in the upper limb or a lower limb. Ultrasound or a duplex ultrasound is a very important diagnostic tool, and it is the advantage of it being it is a non-invasive and it is easily available even in a peripheral setup. Okay, so, but if there is proximal involvement, especially if the involvement is iliac, then duplex is not very reliable. And hence you would then go ahead with an angiogram. Now, different types of angiograms are available. One is contrast CT angiogram and conventional angiogram or a DSA angiogram and an MR angiogram. What do you know any differences between all these? Why exactly do you prefer?
Sir, DSA, we will, it is digital subtraction angiogram, sir. In that, we will first take an image of the vessel, and then after giving contrast, we will just subtract the soft tissues.
What is the advantage?
Sir, advantage in calcified vessels, it is useful, sir.
So, conventional angiogram or DSA angiogram, usually the advantage of it being, it is a diagnostic as well as a therapeutic tool. So you can do a diagnostic angiogram as well as at the same setting, you can do a therapeutic. You can offer both at the same time. Whereas in a CT or an MR angiogram, you cannot do both. So CT and MR is just only a diagnostic tool. So that is the important differentiating factor. If you based on your duplex, you found that there's this very small lesion, which is amenable for an angioplasty, then you do a angiogram and then a conventional angiogram. And then after that, you can plan for an angioplasty. So that is the advantage of a conventional angiogram over CT or a MR angiogram.
Dr. Kirtana.
Yes, sir.
Just since the question of some of the principles of management were asked, just want to impress upon you that most important is relieving the pain, which has been already clarified. That if a patient is coming walking to you with the pain, for example, this patient definitely requires admission.
Yes,
so, other methods like head end elevation, Burgess exercises are there, even a little bit of heel raise. These are the things which have been mentioned for a Burgess disease.
Yes,
because
sir,
where probably surgery is not contemplated, you know. That's second principle, what you should mention is to arrest the progression of the disease.
Yes, sir.
What are the things which you advise the patient?
Sir, to stop smoking, sir. Control of obesity and control of diabetes and reducing obesity, sir.
So that is an important thing you should tell the patient.
Yes,
to relieve the pain, to arrest the progress of the disease. Regular exercises, hypertension to be controlled. Obesity and foot is the site for injuries.
Yes,
so to minimize the injuries, these are the possible things what you can do. Then some pharmacotherapy, then comes the other treatment. So these are the principles. So in the exam, it depends upon the type of patient and what question is asked to you. You know, that is the, if they ask you what, how to investigate, then it is a different type of answering. How do you manage, or what exactly, like when he has come to your clinic there, who is really suffering with the pain? Yes, that is the thing. Then otherwise, these are the things. So you need to see what type of patient you are having and then answer.
Yes,
that's all.
Kirtana, you know what is CO2 angiography?
Yes, sir. Latest technique, sir.
Mm-hmm. What is that? When it is done. If you are not able to do a contrast angiography as such, okay, like in the CT angiography when you are doing, you cannot inject the contrast.
Yes, sir.
When you are doing the typical angiography, the Seldinger's technique you're doing, you're not able to inject the contrast because of the renal status which is there, or even in the MR also, you know? Because that is MR when you sometimes give the drug like gadolinium is given. Yeah, so that is also slightly nephrotoxic. You know? So in those cases, you can go for the CO2 angiography.
Okay, sir.
you know, when we are talking about the principles of the treatment of a, you know, your patient is a patient with a chronic limb ischemia, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So apart from all those, that the patient's pain has to be relieved first, there's no doubt about that.
Yes, sir.
Your principles has to be based on that, how much is the degree of the tissue loss which is there.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then you have to look for the vascular anatomy. That what is the vascular anatomy in that? Then you have to look for what are the comorbidities of that patient. Based on that, you have to decide your treatment.
Yes, sir.
And you have to see also for that, what are the various types of vascular conduits which are available to you. So can you tell what are the various types of vascular conduits which can be used for the revascularization of the limb?
Venous graft, sir, where we can use the great saphenous vein. Reversed great saphenous vein can be used, sir. Then sometimes if the GSV is not available, we can use the short saphenous vein, sir. Then Dacron and Daflon and polytetrafluoroethylene, PTFE graft, sir. Mm-hmm. Then umbilical vein graft can be used after conditioning. That's all.
Now, if you have to use the great saphenous vein, do you know what are the various ways you can do the use the great saphenous vein?
Sir, in situ and...
In situ and? Reverse vein graft.
Reverse, yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, so, sir. Why you do a reverse vein graft?
Because the valves will be there, so we reverse the vein, sir.
So, in situ, what happens? What you do? In situ, what you do? You know, walls are there in situ also. So what you do to the walls? You have to destroy the walls, you know, with the help of the valvulotome. Otherwise, the flow will not be going there. You know? So you have to destroy the walls there, Jay.
Yes.
Right? Okay. Okay.
Just another comment, because he's a diabetic, if this was a diabetic foot ulcer, do you know of any classifications for diabetic foot ulcers?
Magnus classification is this.
Okay, one is Wagner's then. Any other classifications which you know?
For this patient, sir?
No, generally for a diabetic foot ulcer. So there is Texas University classification for diabetic foot ulcers, and those with peripheral arterial disease, and it's very, very important now, now that we've also diagnosed a patient to have ischemia, and there is also foot infection, as well as long-standing diabetes. So it's, there's something called as a wound ischemia and foot infection classification, Wi-Fi score it's called.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that is very important for us. If a diabetic is there, you need to know a little bit about Wi-Fi score, because that will help you to prognosticate the further management.
Yes, okay, sir.
So that, so in a diabetic foot, usually do you think there will be pain?
No, sir. They'll have neuropathies.
Okay. So then, why do you think there's pain here?
So there will be, because of substance P, sir, anaerobic metabolism.
So usually in the foot, in a diabetic foot, if there is a deep-seated abscess, then the patient will have severe pain. And it's very important to get that clinical finding, because if the patient has got severe neuropathy, but yet patient has got severe pain, that means there is a deep-seated abscess, especially in a case like what you presented. If there is edema, there is erythema, and there are signs of wet infection, and if the patient is screaming in pain, obviously there is a deep-seated abscess within the foot.
Okay, sir.
And which is causing that. So it's important to identify that and treat that. Otherwise, no matter what you do, his pain will not get relieved unless you drain the abscess.
If the dry gangrene is there, will you amputate that or not?
Sir, first we have to vascularize and then go for amputation, sir.
So it will be much better that if you can go for any revascularization.
Yes, sir.
And how do you decide that which patient can go for the open surgery and which patient can go for the endovascular surgery?
Based on the task criteria, sir.
What is that?
Sir, that is, there are four, sir, A, B, C, and D. Patients with A and B type of lesions, they benefit from endovascular, sir. Patients with C, but if they are at high risk for surgery, then they will benefit from endovascular procedure. And patients in D category, they benefit from open surgery, sir.
And the task is for different levels, it is a different one, okay?
Yes, sir.
Auto-iliac is different, femoral popliteal is different, below popliteal is different.
What is TAS?
Sir, Transatlantic Inter...
Societal Consensus.
Yeah, okay,
yeah, that's good.
Right. Okay. Now tell the newer methods which are there for the peripheral occluded diseases. Relative newer, I will not say they are very new, but what are the various concepts which has come? You know what is the angiosome concept?
Angiosomes, yes, sir. The vascular territories, sir. If we revascularize the particular vascular territory, then the perfusion will improve, sir.
So in the foot, how many territories are there?
Sir, anterior tibial, posterior tibial, and the peroneal territories, sir. Three are there.
There are five. There are five or six are there. In total body, how many territories are there? It's around 35, you know.
Yes,
in whole of the body, it says there are around 35 angiosomes were there.
Yes,
in
sir.
The foot, it is around 5 to 6 which are there.
Yes.
So, and what do you understand by the stem cells for the ischemic limb? Have you heard about that?
Yes, sir.
Hmm.
Sir, they will inject stem cells to the necrosed tissue.
No, not to the necrosed tissue, ischemic tissue. You know?
Tissue
if something is necro, nothing, it will not come back.
Yes.
In the ischemic tissue, it has been tried, but results are still, you know, they are just experimental. You know? It is still not there.
Yes, sir.
Then various type of growth factors which are there.
Yes, sir.
Okay, various type of growth factors which has been tried for that. So these are the few newer concepts which are there.
Yes,
and
sir.
Definitely, you know, if there's a chronic, there's a wound is there, then the hyperbaric oxygen, VAC therapy, and all those things are there as a relatively newer concept for the occluded disease.
Yes, sir.
Just a final question from me. This was a patient with thromboangitis obliterans. What are the criteria which you know?
Schionoia criteria, sir.
Okay, very good. So there's one clinical, which is a Schionoia's criteria. Second criteria, do you know? It's an Ollens criteria. Essentially, it involves the presence of corkscrew collaterals on an angiogram.
Yes,
so that
sir.
Is Ollens. So Schionoia's and Ollens. These are the two things which you need to know
yes,
just
sir.
To describe that. But all in all, you've done very well.
Yes, I think that, yes, you have done really, because more or less, we have tried to cover out from the clinical part to the history. We have done around a... extensive coverage. I think that you have well read and you have presented by. So from my side, you have done good, real good in an examination. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Ketna, okay. You would like to have any doubts to be clear? Ajay Khanna, sir, any closing comments, sir, before we call across?
I think probably we are gone enough for that. It's already
yes, done. Sir. Thank you, sir. So with that, we come to the close for the session. I thank Dr. Ramanuj, sir. Ramanuj, sir, was a faculty in one other program in Delhi. And
yeah,
he had
thank
to finish.
You,
sir. He has to finish that and honor our request also. So thank you, Ramanuj, sir, for having a back-to-back 3-4 hours of academic in the
sir,
evening.
It was an honor and a privilege, sir, particularly sitting with Shanai sir, Srinivas sir, Khanna sir, and Dr. Albert, please. It was really an honor to be sitting with you.
We are blessed every Friday, sir, to listen to them, and it's learning, relearning, relearning. And our students are exceptionally good, and they stimulate us to learn more and more. So credits to both the teachers, one Dr. Srinivasan and another one is Dr. Vivek for preparing the students and bringing them. I'm sure both the students are present in or are in the department. So that has helped them to definitely take up the questions in a better way. So definitely, I look forward to all the examiners very shortly in one of our next teaching program. And I thank the students for joining us both in YouTube as well as in the Zoom. So with that, with the permission of the faculty, we call the session a close. Thank you and good night to all of you.
Thank you. And a good night. Thank you, sir.
Good night.